Greetings to you wherever you are. My name is Queenlet. This week we've heard a very sad news concerning our beloved minister, Minister Osinachi from Nigeria, who died out of domestic violence, allegedly. A whole lot of people have said so many things concerning her death. And finally, the leader of her church, Dunamis International Gospel Center, Dr. Pastor Paul Enenche, has also come out to share his view concerning what he knows about this particular situation. Please, let's listen to him.
We bring you greetings in Jesus' name.
We are in a season that calls for sober reflection in the light of the passing of our beloved sister, Osinachi Nwachukwu, who is a kingdom asset and a generational asset to this generation. In the light of so much misinformation, in the light of so much misconstruction of events, I decided to set straight what I know concerning the situation. Over 2.5 months to 3 months ago, she came to see me with her husband with complaints of chest pain, respiratory distress. I prayed for her and prayed again. And when the symptoms did not abate, I counseled that they go to the hospital to help us to know exactly what we were dealing with.
So please note this. It was alleged that the husband hit her in the chest, and that is the cause of her death. And I want you to know that the senior pastor is also a medical doctor. So he will say so many things. He will use a lot of medical terms. I just want you to have a general idea that he is a medical doctor. Okay? So let's go ahead.
And they asked if I could assist, help them facilitate that process. I called our head of medical team, Dr. Sang, who is consultant pediatrician with the Federal Medical Center, KEFI, to assist handle their situation. And he called the Federal Medical Center, Jabi, called colleagues there, where they attended to them. On seeing her, they ordered some investigations after examination, and that included CT scan, computerized axial tomography scan. That was done, and from what the doctor saw, they felt that there was need for further investigation, either at the University of Abuja Teaching Hospital or the National Hospital in Abuja. I called the doctor, consultant pulmonologist, respiratory physician at the University of Abuja Teaching Hospital, Dr. Akko Alexander, told him the situation, and he asked that they come to see him immediately. And they went to the Gwagwalada Teaching Hospital. After they had examined her there and saw the situation, they felt that there was a need for histology and biopsy of the lung tissue. And they asked that she go to the National Hospital to get that done.
So from what he is saying, all this happened 2-3 months ago. The late minister came to him together with her husband, complaining about her chest and respiratory disorder. He prayed as a pastor for her over and over and over again, and he saw that the symptoms were not going down. Okay, so he decided they go see a doctor, and they ask if he could help because they know he's a medical doctor, and then he referred them to all those doctors. He mentioned their names.
I called the Dr. Jibrin, who is head of pathology and consultant histopathologist of the National Hospital in Abuja, and reported the issue to him and to help us go ahead with the investigations and find out what exactly happened. I am calling names and calling places because the people are available and alive, and they are all verifiable. And then they continued the management. The histology was done. From what I saw at that time, The picture was much milder than what the CT scan earlier on showed. And so we felt very happy that at least there was relief. She called me daily, and literally daily, and prayed with her. She reported progress. The point came where she needed no oxygen anymore, according to what she said to me one night, and that they checked her oxygen perfusion, and it was 100%. And we were very, very excited at that progress. That was the point it was before we went over to the crusade in Cameroon. It was in Cameroon the second night that I got to know of the unfortunate incident of her passing. Now,
So before the doctor went to Cameroon, everything was good. She was in order. Everything about her respiratory disorder was very good. But when the pastor got to Cameroon, the second night, or the day two, he heard about the death of the late minister.
If there was domestic violence that led to or coincided with those symptoms that she came with two and a half months to 3 months ago, there is no way I would know. And if there had been perennial domestic violence, there was no way I would have known.
According to the senior pastor, he never knew if there was any domestic violence affiliated to the chest pain or whatever. He is not aware.
The things we're hearing after her passing were things that were very, very strange to my hearing. Then I began to ask questions. First, I asked the twin sister, are you aware that your sister, were you aware that your sister passed through all these things? She said, yes, she knew some of them, but that the majority of them, she was hearing also from those she confided in. I asked her, I said, if you knew, why didn't you let us know? And the twin sister said, she always begged her, please don't let the church go, don't tell the pastor, please, the man will change, please, just pray for us, the man will change. And that continued to happen. I asked the first son yesterday, I said, was this real? And the son told other stories. And I said, so why didn't you tell me? Because typically they will run to me after service, and I'll pray for them, lay hands on them. Why didn't you tell me about what was going on in the home? And the young man said, they couldn't tell me because the father would always ask them after they left me and said, what did you tell the pastor? Did you tell him anything? And so on and so forth. Other members in the choir who were privy to this, some of the things that were going on, I asked one of them when we paid the visit to the house of the deceased yesterday, what happened? Why were we not aware of all these things? The same story, that she would always go on her knees and ask them, please, don't. Just pray, don't. By trusting God for him to change. The last one that taught me so much was the music producer who came to see me in the office 2 days ago to tell me his own experience, how he witnessed that the man slapped the wife in his music studio. And I said to him, you saw a man slap a woman in your presence, and you left the man alone, and you are a man yourself. And he said before he could respond to the man, the woman again in tears on her knees begged him not to do anything, to leave him alone, and not even to do anything at all, and so on and so forth. So we have had these stories. And this is all the things that we got to know after she had passed. As a person and as a church, everyone who knows us know that we have 0 degree tolerance for domestic abuse and wife battery of any sort. If you ever listen to any of our relationship messages, there is a principle, a policy, and a rule we have, and that is, it is better to be alive without a marriage than to die because of marriage. We've said that over and over and over.